method of estimating carbon footprint. I set the context of why it is necessary to discuss carbon footprint in the context of global warming, and using some very elementary calculations. Am I audible completely?
Yes, sir. You are loud and clear.
Yeah, right. So, using some elementary calculations, this is not a very involved presentation. So, some other day we would make a very detailed presentation of this. I would try to explain this concept of carbon footprint. Okay. So, this is the objective of this lecture. Why is it necessary to talk about carbon footprint? It is because there is a talk of climate change, and there is a consensus about the climate change, meaning that human beings, or in technical language, it's called as anthropogenic emissions. So anthropogenic emissions, that is the emissions because of the industrial activity as well as some agricultural activity of human beings, it is responsible for global warming and climate change. So this is a consensus, and consensus meaning about 97% of the climate scientists, they agree to this. And they are the findings are tabulated in the reports which are published by Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC. Even agencies like International Energy Agency and World Bank, they also agree that we are heading towards catastrophic climate change. And if we don't quantify the carbon footprint, and if we don't do anything about it, then it is impossible to achieve the target, okay, the target of keeping our emissions below 2 degrees as compared to the emissions in the industrial era, post-industrial era. Okay, and in order to do that, there has to be some quantification of those emissions, the greenhouse gas emissions, and that is what is the carbon footprint. Okay, so this is the context of discussing the topic of carbon footprint. If we look at the emissions, okay, emissions, the very interesting a comparison I would like to make. One is the emissions on per capita basis and the emissions on the absolute basis. Meaning what? Meaning if you consider, for example, if you look at this, China, you know that it is the most populous country, and people there are involved in some industrial activity. So they together as a whole population would contribute to the climate change. Okay, so the emissions together of the Chinese population, that comes to around 13 to 14 gigatons of CO2 equivalent. Okay, so you find that China as well as the other countries, they are responsible for emitting maximum amount of greenhouse gases, okay, on the absolute basis, that is on the total basis, the total population, the Chinese population is contributing in a big way to the CO2 emissions. Similarly, United States of America, the European Union, as well as India, Russia, Japan, okay, they all contribute to the carbon emissions in a big way on the absolute basis. But if you look at it from the per capita basis means if you divide the total emissions by the population, then it becomes the emission per head. So if you look at that kind of emissions, then that carbon footprint per head, obviously it would come highest for the most developed or most industrialized country, which is America, United States of America. Because you know that if you look at the data, for example, the number of cars owned or the number of air conditioners in the owned. Okay, so all this data, which generally comes with prosperity, the number of ACs, number of cars and all that, that is highest in United States of America. So per capita emissions from or the carbon footprint generated by America is the highest, okay, followed by Russia, Japan, and China. And also, relatively speaking, the Indian carbon footprint is less. But please note that our absolute carbon footprint is increasing in a big way. So, so all the developed countries, as well as the so-called developing countries, they agree that something has to be done about it. And based on this understanding, they came together at Paris, okay. Earlier also, and this, which is all of you know that the Paris Climate Conference agreed or it set the target of achieving the industrial, the reference being the industrial emissions. Okay, So this, in order to achieve this, obviously it is not a binding kind of thing, but nevertheless, there is a consensus that something has to be done about it. What happened was, in the agreement, it was realized that the ability of the parties to adapt to the climate change, okay, we need to make some leeway for the industrial growth, and hence the non-binding targets were set. As I said, the target was to keep the average temperature well below 2 degrees centigrade above the pre-industrial level, and if possible, keep it to 1.5 degrees centigrade. Okay. In order to do that, and because it was left to the individual countries to do that, unfortunately, nothing has been concretely decided. Okay. Still, policymakers want that the people, the industries, they do. So how do you restrict the emissions? And it is done by calculating the carbon footprint each industry, each organization, each family generates. Okay. So how do you do that? So in order to explain you this, I had taken one example of calculation of carbon footprint of a family. So you all know that family consumes electricity for its needs. Depending upon the level of income which the family gets, the electricity consumption, it would change. The electricity, assuming that majority of the electricity, especially in our country, is contributed by coal-based power plants. Okay, so the coal-based power plants, as Professor Patil was talking about in the morning, right? So they would emit CO2 in a big way, and they would contribute to the carbon footprint. So we need to consider the electricity consumption of the family in order to calculate the carbon footprint of the family. Similarly, a family would consume LPG for cooking, which is, you all know, it's a fossil fuel, propane plus butane, and that would result in carbon dioxide emissions. Same is about transport, and even as was discussed in the morning's lecture, that even electric cars would contribute to the carbon footprint. It's because though the tailpipe emissions, they reduce significantly when you are using electric cars, but if the electricity comes from a fossil fuel based power plant, then the emissions which is generated at the power plant plus the emissions and also the inefficiencies associated with transmitting and distributing that electricity up to the electric car, that has to be taken into account. And in fact, if you consider emissions from a petrol car and emissions from a electric car, which is completely driven by fossil fuel based electricity, then charged by fossil fuel based electricity, then the emissions of the carbon footprint generated by the electric cars would be higher. Okay, obviously with the solar PV systems, the things are changing, and if you imagine that all the electric cars are powered by solar PV, then obviously the carbon footprint even of cars would be less. The family might take to travel, and that might consume certain fuel and contribute to the carbon footprint. Not only this, even the consumption of the goods, okay, which the family does, that has to be accounted in the calculation of carbon footprint. Now, in order to do that, I will just demonstrate this with certain expressions. Okay, and this is very pretty simple. So what I said is the carbon footprint is expressed generally in terms of equivalent. Okay, why this equivalent term is used, I'll come to that shortly. So obviously, if I want to calculate for a family, and you can do the calculations for your own family, you need to know how much is the LPG consumed by the family. That is the number of cylinders consumed per year, annual consumed. I'm calculating the annual carbon footprint. You know that a cylinder, for example, a typical cylinder comes in 14.2 kgs, and the emission factor, and I'll come to that, how these emission factors are calculated. As LPG is 2.95 kgs. Similarly, you know the electricity consumption, and it comes from the energy bill which is received monthly. So if you do the totaling of the electricity consumed by the family, and if you multiply it with the emission factor, and you see that in all my expressions, I'm dividing it by 1000. So all my expressions, you see that the denominator is 1000. So the 1000 is because I want to convert that kgs of CO2 equivalent to tons of CO2 equivalent. Okay. So every ton of CO2 equivalent which is equal to one carbon footprint that way. Right. So you see that a ready data of a family for LPG consumption, a ready data for a family of the electricity consumption, a ready data for the family for the number of kilometers traveled could be obtained, and the respective emission factors need to be considered in arriving at the CO2 which is being emitted. Now, how these emission factors are arrived at? Okay, so again, I will just repeat the emission factor for LPG, how it is calculated, the emission factor for electricity, and the emission factor for petrol. Okay, so for example, I had taken an example of diesel. The diesel emission factor is 2.63 kgs of CO2 equivalent. Okay, so how is this arrived at? So those who have studied chemistry, they know that the fuel, ultimate analysis of the fuel is important to understand its structure, and all these fossil fuels are basically hydrocarbons. So considering this, if you have carbon, if you take the typical composition of diesel, which is carbon 86.2%, and if I assume that the entire amount of diesel is converted to CO2 by complete combustion, obviously, as in the morning we had the discussion that there could be incomplete combustion and there are other emissions also. But to make the thing simple, if you consider that the entire fuel is completely burned, right, then the emission factors can be calculated. Okay, so C+ would give CO2. It means that if you have 12 kgs of carbon in the fuel, that would give you 44 kgs of CO2. This way, you can calculate what is the CO2 emitted per kg of diesel. So for example, the diesel having 86.2 kgs per 100 kgs or 0.862 kgs per kg of diesel would emit 3.16 kgs of CO2. It's pure mathematics. Okay. And if I want to express, because generally we don't talk in terms of kgs of diesel, we talk in terms of diesel liters. So just we need to consider the density of the fuel to arrive at the CO2 emissions per liter of diesel. Now, obviously, and this is pretty obvious to you, that depending upon the mileage of the vehicle and depending upon the number of people who are traveling in that vehicle, the emission factor would change. Okay, so assuming that the average or the mileage of the car is 15 kilometers per liter, one can calculate and show that the carbon footprint generated every kilometer, okay, carbon footprint generated every kilometer would be 0.176 kgs if you are traveling by diesel car. Okay, so this is how you calculate the carbon footprint. Similarly, for calculating the carbon footprint from the coal-based electricity, right? You need to consider the overall efficiency of the plant, the calorific value of the fuel. So, for example, if you are talking about typical 1 kilowatt output from a thermal power plant, then the coal consumption using this overall plant efficiency of 30% would be around 0.0002 kgs per second. Okay. So, this elementary calculation. So, for example, if you operate this plant for 1 hour, then that consumption could come to be around 0.75 kgs. How this you are getting? By multiplying it with 3600. So this is how you calculate the carbon footprint for every unit of electricity generated. Okay, so this is 0.75 kgs of carbon consumed per unit. Now 0.75 kgs is not the carbon footprint which is generated. It is 0.75 is the fuel consumption, coal consumption per unit. If you take a typical composition of coal, obviously these calculations would depending upon the grade of the coal which the power plant uses, right? So if you take the ultimate analysis of the coal having this composition, again, as I showed in the last slide, you can calculate what is the CO2 which is being emitted for generating one unit of electricity. So if I'm generating one unit of electricity, it would take 0.75 kgs of coal, and because for burning every kg of coal, as I have shown in this calculation, about 1.43 kgs of CO2 would be emitted. Okay, so obviously, if I want to generate one unit of electricity, the carbon footprint for generating one unit of electricity comes to around 1. Okay, and then somebody would say that why you are taking the entire thing for coal? It could be that the thermal power plant could have some electricity coming from coal, some from hydro, some from solar, and so on. So depending upon that, obviously, this mix would change. For example, in France, you know that the major contribution is from nuclear. Okay, so that way, your calculations, depending upon the grid, depending upon what is being contributed to the grid, how much is the coal, how much is the hydro. Hydro generally is considered to be clean, but then it is very complicated because if especially from large hydroelectric power plants, it would lead to submergence of large areas of forest, and that has to be considered when you are talking about carbon footprint. Okay, so that's way, this way this carbon footprint calculations are done. How do you do it for industry? Okay, because especially for industry, it is very important. The energy intensive industries, they are now being footprint, and they are also into some market mechanisms called as PAT. PAT means performance achievement trade. Okay, so that this could be debatable whether market mechanisms are to be used for controlling the carbon emissions. That is a debatable issue. But nevertheless, for the industries, in the future, they will have to calculate the carbon footprint which they generate, and they would have to discuss as to what kind of interventions they need to do so as to reduce the carbon footprint. Okay. So similar to what we had talked about when you are doing the carbon footprint calculations of a family, we can do the similar kind of calculations by taking the energy bill of the industry, by considering the consumption of the diesel for the company vehicles, talking about the travel which the management might take, especially the air travel for leisure, for work, and the carbon footprint which is generated by the raw materials on the downstream side, and by the finished products also. Okay, so generally when you are talking about carbon footprint for an industry, they are talking in terms of this terminology: scope 1, scope 2, and scope 3. So the picture is self-explanatory as to what this emissions would have to be, which emissions are to be considered in scope 1, which is indirect emissions for calculation of carbon footprint, and what is to be considered in the carbon footprint for scope 3 calculations. So this is a there is a protocol, and because this is an introductory lecture, I don't want to go into the details of that. This becomes an elaborate exercise of calculating the carbon footprint for the industry. Now, what is this carbon dioxide equivalent? Okay, as I said, that carbon footprint, we talk in terms of CO2 equivalent and not simply CO2. This is because not only CO2, but other gases, they also contribute to the carbon footprint. And these gases, which are the gases which contribute to the carbon footprint? So it is agreed upon when there were discussions at the Kyoto Protocol that these six gases, that is along with carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, hydrofluorocarbons, perfluorocarbons, sulfur hexafluoride, all these gases, they contribute to the global warming in a big way. And if you look at these numbers, for example, the global warming potential of methane, for example, what this table tells you is that the global warming potential of methane is 28 times that of the CO2. Okay, and accordingly, so you see that the other gases are also contributing to the CO2 equivalent. And we need to consider the emissions of methane, nitrous oxide, all these gases when you do the carbon footprint calculations. So this I had already discussed that how do you do the calculations for direct emissions. So direct emissions would include what? It would include the generation of electricity from the fossil fuels. Means, for example, an industry might have a boiler. Okay, the boiler would emit certain, would generate certain steam for process heating, for example, or it might have a cogeneration facility wherein it is going to produce the electricity for its in-house consumption. So that has to be accounted for in the direct emissions. Then the transport of main end material owned by buses, cars, trucks, etc. Okay, and that has to be accounted in the direct emissions. Then emissions from the physical and chemical processes. Okay, for example, in cement, aluminium, chemical manufacturing, all these industries, there would be some direct emissions. So those direct emissions, for example, if there is some methane emission, and you know the quantity of methane emissions, so it would be 28 times that of harmful as compared to CO2. Okay, so the quantity of methane generated into the equivalent carbon CO2 equivalent, we can calculate the leakage of gases which are involved, intentional or unintentional. All this would be considered when you do the scope 1 calculations. Okay. In the scope 2 calculations, now why something has to be included in scope 1 and why something has to be included in scope 2? Because there could be debate on that, that why you are not using electricity in scope 1 calculations and why you are talking about scope, you are putting electricity in scope 2. Okay, but that is a different aspect to the debate, right? Now, present for our present purposes, we simply say that these are agreed upon, that the electricity supplied by the grid has to be taken into scope 2 emissions. If you are buying some thermal energy from outside, say you are taking the steam from the nearby unit, then you would consider it as indirect emissions in the scope 2 thing. As I said, the transport of materials, raw materials, and the transport of finished products, they are also to be considered in the scope 3 calculations. Okay. So this is pretty clear to you what things are to be considered in scope 1, scope 2, and scope 3. Okay, I had taken some case studies, some simple cases. For example, this is one industry which is emitting 10 tons of CO2, some 100 kgs of methane, and consume some hydrofluorocarbons. So you need to estimate that. Okay, so simple back of the envelope calculations you can do. This 100 kgs means 0.1 ton. It's 28 times more contributor as compared to CO2. So it would give you 2.8 tons of CO2 equivalent. Similarly, about HFCs, you can do the calculations and then you can total up this, and that comes to 15.28 tons of CO2 equivalent. Okay, this is the back of the envelope calculations. Okay, this again shows the emission factors from different sources. Again, using your stoichiometric calculations. Coal fired, you get emission factor. I had shown you this explanation emission factor of coal based. Similarly, by considering the ultimate analysis of diesel, natural gas, and of estimate the emission factors. Even if it is a CNG vehicle, diesel vehicle, all these are hydrocarbons and they are going to contribute to the emissions. So this I need not explain, I guess. This is one example of how do you account for the products. As I said, that major energy consuming industry like cement, aluminium, etc., they are now required by law to calculate their carbon footprint and abide by the carbon targets. Okay, so they need to worry about their product emissions, and this is a typical example I've taken from emission factors which are computed by Terry. Terry is the Energy Policy Research Institute. It is called the Energy Research Policy Institute, TERI. And this typical example shows you that if you want to generate, produce 1 ton of cement, then that 1 ton of cement would emit how much of CO2? That the thermal energy contribution to the cement production would generate 0.23 tons of CO2 equivalent for every ton of cement, and some contribution would also come from electrical energy side. So this two, summation of these two would be the total CO2 equivalent. Okay, total CO2 equivalent when you are producing 1 ton of, you can do for aluminium industry and all other energy, for paper industry, all industries which are considered to be the major industries contributing to the global warming, and which are now being forced upon to take some initiative under the PAT scheme. This is the way you measure the carbon footprint. You need to define the boundaries and scope, decide the base year, because without the base year, you cannot understand whether the carbon footprint is reducing or increasing. And for that, you need to take some primary data and the data from the energy bill, the transport data, how many kilometers the vehicle is traveling, the logbook data, all this data you need to do. Apply the emission factors and calculate the carbon. And this is how you report it. Finally, I will end this presentation of mine by talking about the paradox. Okay, this is very interesting. This has been pointed out by a very famous environmentalist. You all know that hot climates, and it is agreed upon by the climate scientists, that hot climates are being experienced because of the fossil fuel which is being consumed by all of us. Because to sustain our lifestyles, I run my AC, in order to counter the hot climate. Okay, I run my fan in order to counter the hot climate, all these things. Okay, and this in order to counter all these hot climates, we are again powering our ACs, air conditioning systems. We are flying to colder climates. For example, I fly to Manali or I fly to European countries. Not now because it is not possible, right? Or I consume refrigerated products like ice creams and all that. And in this in turn would consume more fossil fuels. I am assuming that the electricity is coming from escape the heat. We are consuming more fossil fuel consumption, and this fossil fuel consumption is again making the climate hotter. So what needs to be done is, in my opinion, is we need to look at both the demand side as well as the technology side. So it's not simply possible to reduce the carbon footprint or face the climate challenge by simply concentrating our efforts on improving the efficiencies of the fossil.
Professor Sheila, please switch on your mic. I think you are not audible. Hello, sir.
Hello.
Okay.
Am I audible now?
Yes, you are.
Okay. So my speech was not audible to you?
No, last slide, sir.
Achha, last slide was not audible.
Okay. Fine.
So what did you skip? What topic? The paradox you skip? This was not...
Paradox is covered only last sentence that efforts to escape.
Okay. Take it. All right. That was all right. Take it. Okay. Any queries or thing?
Participants can unmute yourself and then ask question. Or drop your query in chat box. Meanwhile, I just wish to announce regarding the feedback forms. All the participants are requested to fill the feedback forms, mail to you, and then e-certificates will be issued to you. Okay, so please give your valuable feedback to us, and any query. Anybody wants to talk, you can unmute yourself and then give your valuable feedback. Okay, the question is from Vipul Chavan. What could be done to reduce carbon footprint?
Okay, so that is what I was talking about. It is not enough to talk about technology, okay, in order to reduce the carbon. Both the technology as well as systems approach has to be taken into consideration for reducing carbon footprint. In order to make myself clear, I'll take an example of transport. Okay, so let us say that we want to travel. Okay, we want to travel 100 kilometers. Okay, and let us say that all of the people are having efficient engines. Okay, and all of them take us individual ride and travel 100 kilometers. Right, assuming that all of them are using efficient vehicles, Okay, you can do the calculations as I had shown, okay, and calculate the carbon footprint for that. Now consider a scenario where you have a very good public transport bus, okay, which is comfortable, which is efficient, and which caters to those 100 people, and they are taken to the same spot, right? And again, assume that that efficiency of that vehicle is a bit less as compared to the individual bikes. If you do the carbon footprint calculations, you would make out that this public transport bus, okay, public transport bus has generated far less carbon footprint as compared to the combo of the 100 efficient bikes. So I hope I have made the point clear.
Are electric cars are feasible cost-wise and truly green?
As we had a sufficient discussion on that, in the morning also Professor Patil hinted about the problem with electric vehicles. If the electric vehicles, okay, they are fueled by electricity coming from the coal-based power plants, or for that matter, any fossil fuel-based car, power plant, then though we are offsetting the emissions from the tailpipes, okay, the overall carbon footprint generated would be much higher than those by the fossil fuel-based cars. Okay, so electric cars, if they are fueled by, let us say, renewables, you can imagine that, let us say, solar PV becomes affordable, and it is you are having a battery which is a long life battery, and I'm coming at my home, I charge my battery with solar PV, and then I use that for charging, and I use that battery for driving my car. So if that happens, then obviously the carbon footprint generated by that electric car would be less, okay, than the than an efficient fossil fuel based car. So that is but obvious. However, we need to also consider that, imagine that India has one car per capita, okay, and all are electric cars. So you can imagine the scenario, what would happen. For example, the number of roads we need to construct for that, right? And the deforestation we need to do for that, right? Then assuming that the cars would be manufactured from some materials which are again coming from an energy intensive factory. So we need to consider that carbon footprint which is generated. So all in all, if you see that, simply technological solutions are not the way out.
Okay, sure, sir. And also lifestyle plays an important role, like carpooling.
Right, that's what I was hinting at, that if you are not curtailing your consumption, okay, and if you are not switching on to a green consumption, okay, what is green consumption? We need to look at it at a separate talk, right? It is impossible to simply achieve the carbon footprint and meet the targets which are set at the Paris conference.
Okay. So with this, I would like to conclude today's session. I extend my thanks to Dr. Shelar for your very simple brief introduction about carbon footprint. And I would also like to thank conveyor of today's workshop, Dr. Kushare and Dr. Barate. Also, our head of department, Professor Murukka sir, for his mentoring to organize such a workshop. So I again thank you all participants, and please fill the feedback forms. Thank you all.
Thank you very much.